That didn't go off very well, so I got married and had my child at 16. Again, I didn't want to take the responsibility of my actions, so I went into the marriage bitter, but determined to make it work. My husband and I were two kids playing house. We began going out to clubs, drinking and living it up. I thought at this time that I had found it, this was the life. Right before our third wedding anniversary, my husband was shot and killed at one of those live it up nightclubs. Well,
before my husband left, I made promises that I
save money that my sugar daddy gave me, and only two girls occasionally. I was only able to keep one, and that was to be faithful. I literally stayed in my bedroom and bathroom for 2 years, waiting for the day my husband would come home and make me happy again. But there was a problem. The needle slowly became my friend, lover, and my reason for living. I lost the glimpse of self-respect that I had left. I spent hours in the bathroom fixing and crying because a syringe owned me now. There was nothing that I could do. As a result of shooting dope, I began to miss a lot, and those misses turned into infected sores from my head to my toes. I spent a lot of time telling my daughter and parents that those sores on me were just boils. I didn't realize how sick I had become. I lost everything. I was a zombie with no feelings for anyone or anything except my rush. I remember thinking that when my husband came home I could put in everything would be alright. It wasn't. I tried staying clean for a while. I worked in a furniture store my father had started for us, but nothing worked. Before long I was a bit abandoned. By this time I was completely out of control. There were no veins left, so I had to go in about 1⁄2 inch to find one, and I nearly lost my veins for good. All this time I was trying to be a mother, wife, and girlfriend. I'd dress myself up for a day, put on my mask and perform my duties, but it never did work. I had no motivation to help myself. During the worst time of my addiction, my thoughts were never suicidal. I just wanted to sleep till it all went away. My old ideas told me it was a sin to take my own life. I couldn't really see that I was slowly doing just that. As deep as I was into my habit, it wasn't long before I was selling everything. I had run out of lies to tell my money man, so next went my house, cars, and jewelry. I didn't care, I had to have my dope. There were people reaching out to me with all they had, but all I could do was shoot more dope. When someone tried to get close to this scared little girl, I didn't have any idea how to respond. I didn't have the strength to get out of it at all. It wasn't long, till I got busted again. This time it was different. It was the end for me. I had never been one to assist cops in anything, but now the running was over and I knew it. I told them exactly what I had done and I didn't really care what the consequences were, I just wanted out. I was picked up at a drugstore and taken to jail. I was so messed up that nothing mattered, nothing. 140 Narcotics Anonymous. I was unable to walk. Both my legs were so bent from infection that I couldn't straighten them out. I was carried by the nurses before the judge to have my bond set. As foggy-headed as I was, I'll never forget the voices of disgust and pity as I was carried into the courtroom. Something inside my sick mind and heart told me it was finally all over. I suddenly realized how close I was to prison or even death. Without my knowledge, my father had found a lawyer to get me out. The nurses informed me that I was on my way to a hospital, police escort and all. Before I left the jail, my lawyer arrived. He came in, introduced himself, and then proceeded to tell me the most frightening words I'd ever heard, "It's time for you to grow up." He told me the only reason he was taking my case was because he hated to see a grown man cry, and my father had sat in his office and cried like a baby, pleading with him on my own 2 feet for once and take the responsibility for my actions. I had never been so scared in my life. The things he told me scared me more than anything. Even my arrest and losing my daughter weren't as scary as having to grow up. I didn't know where to begin. I had no idea of how to grow up and no idea of what he really meant, except that it had to be done somehow. When I arrived at the hospital, I was informed that there would be no phone calls in and no phone calls out. I couldn't even talk to my parents. I didn't like that too much, but I knew I had better listen for the first time in my life. My lawyer was the only visitor I had for the first few days and he really helped me laugh at myself. I was laying in bed one day, feeling sorry for myself, and counting my scars. I had 22 of them. He looked at me very seriously and said, "I know what you'll do. You'll paint me green and play dot to dot." I had never in my curious, condemning mind found that I could ever laugh at myself in such a forgiving way. Before, if I laughed at me, I was judging me for being such a failure in life. Now there seemed to be some relief and hope. Nothing was that bad anymore. My next trip was to a treatment center. I was determined to make it work this time. I spent a lot of time preparing myself to go to prison because there just didn't seem to be a way out of it. My lawyer told me there would have to be a miracle somewhere, because I had really gone my limit. I knew this. People just didn't get out of free narcotics arrest, including fraud, without ratting and without going to jail. The song, "Why Me Lord," came. A little girl grows up 141 into my head while I was there and it stayed. Every time I laid down to go to sleep it was there. I had begun to know what gratitude was. My prayers were limited to, "Help me." I didn't know what I was really praying to, but I had to pray anyway. I couldn't carry the burden alone anymore. The people around me were telling me that I had to believe in something bigger and greater than me or I would die. I could look in their eyes and see that they must be telling the truth, but something was there and I wanted it. For the first time I was told I could have my own God who would love and understand me. I could have a God that no one else had if I chose. What a relief this was to me. I no longer had certain rules and regulations to belong somewhere. My God and I could make up our own. Now I was beginning to know what faith was and I had taken the first 3 steps in my life. My heart told me now that whatever happened in my life would be God's will and that my worries could be taken away if I just prayed and believed. It all seemed so simple to do, but my will just wasn't ready to give up. I kept telling myself, "You've made a decision, stick with it for once and see what happens." The words in the third step, "made a decision," scared me because I didn't know what decision meant. I had never decided on anything, I had just reacted. To the best of my ability, I stayed with the third step throughout my time at the treatment center. My next trip was to a halfway house in Birmingham. My counselor recommended that I go, so I could get some time behind me and see what it was really like to be clean for more than 30 days. When she told me the name of the place, I had second thoughts. I thought there would be a bunch of sisters in robes greeting me. I couldn't conceive of living with 18 women under one roof for too long, but I knew I had to go. To my surprise, I was greeted by several lovely women. of love, acceptance and understanding beyond my comprehension. They told me everything was going to be all right, and I believed them with all my heart. My stay there began with mixed emotions. I often wanted to leave, yet my little girl and take off somewhere to get away from all the pain of reality. I also read a great deal about the fourth step and knew it was time to take a fourth step in my life. I spent numerous hours writing about what had happened in my life, the pain I had felt, and the pain I had caused. I wrote about everything. There was a great deal of pain and embarrassment involved, but also an overwhelming feeling of relief. I was finally able to get out all the pain that had been with me all my life. To look at me on a piece. 142 Narcotics Anonymous. A paper, and realized how irresponsible I had been, just verified the fact that there would be no more running. The old me is finally beginning to die. I began to see that I really didn't deserve all the punishment I had bestowed upon myself, and that maybe I was worthy of that thing called happiness. I spent several program has given me everything non-material. Happiness, I used to think, is what and how much I could buy. How little I knew of true happiness. I'm beginning to accept pain as growth. I know pain is essential. Through pain, God can break down many false personalities little by little in his own time. There is so much hope for me today. The program was a challenge that I needed desperately and was given to me as a gift. Each day I want more of what it has to offer. I want so much to learn, and I have a long way to go to reach the understanding I'm searching for. That's okay. At least I'm searching. To put into words what God and the program of Narcotics Anonymous have done for me has been difficult. There aren't words to express God's love. I hope that my story can reach someone, somewhere, but if it doesn't, that's okay, because it has reached me. Thank you, God. Thank you, Narcotics Anonymous, for giving me 144 Narcotics Anonymous. It's okay to be clean. On one of my first drunks, at age 13, I made a fool of myself, got very sick, had trouble with my parents, and was kicked off the basketball team. In one night, I made plenty of reasons not to drink again, a preview of coming attractions. Two important reasons outweighed all the pain and trouble and kept me losing for years. First, was the attention I got at school. I was a celebrity for a short time. The other guys who drank welcomed me into their group and I felt the acceptance I craved. Second, and just as important, I liked it. My friends and I would get in the car and drive out in the country to the same place. similarities instead of differences. I saw that we all share some common feelings and a desire to stop moving. I first got involved in service by 100